Go.
Hi everyone, and welcome to the demo for the Open Science Observatory. Since I'm gonna be sharing my screen, let's leave the questions in the end because I won't be able to read them. And I'll try to leave a few minutes so we have time. Okay, so the Open Science Observatory is a service, a tool that we built in order to help stakeholders, that is policymakers and research administrators and other interested parties, to better understand the European open science landscape. The idea is that using the indicators and visualizations we provide, one can monitor the open science policy uptake and therefore enhance it. Besides open science policy, we also there was also a need to look at these open access publications and see how they behave, and we'll talk about it more later, with respect to the general research landscape. We aimed at providing a picture so that one can check what works and what not, reveal hidden potential, figure out if there's some organization, countries, or areas that are in general lagging behind in terms of infrastructure and uptake. In order to do this, there's a need to compare at different levels of interest, comb through the big amount of data and turn it into insights. And in general, once this picture is clear, promote good practices for open science. So with that in mind, we were trying to build a tool that can be used for monitoring and policy making. And we added some functionalities so that can also be used for storytelling, reporting, and analysis. As with all the open air tools, it's all about open data and open science principles in general. And we're also aiming to provide indicators that have a good coverage, there's completeness, are well documented, so there's transparency in the methodology and documentation, so they can be replicated. So all the information portrayed is based on the platform is based on the open research graph, based on open science principles, so open data sources, APIs, and well documented metrics and indicators. And when we were setting it up, we were sure to talk to stakeholders so that, and we want to keep developing this so that it's relevant for the community. So when we develop the indicators and select the visualizations to show them, we're really interested in customizing it for the policymakers. And this is the approach, basically. I don't know, perhaps some of you have already seen, this is the pipeline for the open air research graph. The main idea is that we harvest a lot of resources, and then we harmonize, deduplicate, interlink, and enrich all the metadata records using also our inference system, in order to have a graph that has a lot of, like a good coverage of relationships and properties of the metadata records. In the end of all this process, which you can find more about in graph.openair.edu, come our platforms that perform statistical analysis on the graph. And here is where the observatory comes in. The monitor also does statistical analysis on the result for another purpose, which we will briefly go over later. Okay, so the Open Science Observatory, which I will very quickly move into the actual demo. I will try to make it a user-friendly data and visualization platform with exporting capabilities. And it is meant to portray the open science uptake across and within European countries. Now, the Open Air Research Graph has a global coverage, but here, at least for now, we're focusing in Europe. It has a set of open science indicators, but also further indicators on these open access research outputs and collaborations, impact, and so on, which we keep building, of course, as we go along. The entities can be broken, the different indicators can be broken down by different fields of interest, such as research outcomes, data sources, organizations, and so on. And this is how this is done in a way that it gives, we try to aim for a complete picture of the uptake across and within European countries. Now, there is the option for looking into detail at the institutional organization level, but this is for this is meant for another service, the Open Air Monitor, which is an on-demand tool for within organization, within funder views. Okay, let's move to the demo. All right, here is the homepage. We start off with a map and several selections at the top, public open access publications, open access data sets, repositories, and open access journals. Let's start with the publications one. First of all, here you get a bird's eye view of the open access publications as they're allocated across Europe. I'm noting here that all the publication indicators in the OS Observatory, I refer to peer-reviewed publications. There are a couple of things on non-peer-reviewed, but they're always explicitly stated. Hovering on top of a country, one can view some summary statistics. For example, for the United Kingdom, we have the peer-reviewed publications affiliated to organization the country, so 630,000. And the ones that are actually deposited in the, one of the country's institutional repositories. Here we can quickly view that there is a big difference between the two numbers. A lot of the publications affiliated to the country are not deposited, saying something, but I don't know what, but saying something about infrastructure and repositories and so on. On the other hand, one can view at Switzerland, where the difference between the affiliated and the deposited is much smaller. Moving along, by the way, clicking on a country actually opens up some summary statistics on the right for the country. And by clicking on view details, you can go to the country page, but we'll review this later on. Okay. When selecting data sets, we see that the numbers are much lower for open access data sets. This could be for several reasons. It could be that the requirements to report the data sets or make them open access are now starting to be included in, for example, funders' mandates and so on. But it could also be about the quality of the metadata. Because in order to assign a data set to a country, the data set must be deposited or harvested from somewhere where there is a proper organization and country metadata elements. So I'm just trying to showcase here the kind of thoughts that have come to mind. Of course, it's just some my own interpretation could be something else. Moving further down the page, there are four boxes of summary statistics. Let's focus on this one here. So there are 3,000 something repositories that are listed in OpenDoor and Retrieved Data. And here you see that only 30% are valid data. This is a good opportunity to showcase the methodology page. So I'm gonna open the terminology and construction in a new tab. Okay, there are different sections of the methodology page, the entities of the graph with the definition, the inherited and inferred attributes, okay? And the constructed attributes where we provide a definition and the, in detail the construction. Of course, if something is not clear, please contact us to amend it. So a validated data source is a data source of research outcomes that upholds metadata standards. In order to estimate this, we use the OpenAIR validator service, and there's a description and a link here. So we see here that although we have this many repositories, so it seems like, you know, we're not doing too bad in terms of repositories, a lot of them actually not satisfying the metadata requirements. So there's something to be learned from there. Moving further down the page, we have in detail view per country for the information portrayed above. So we have repositories, open access journals, publications, data sets, software, and other research products. Sorting, for example, open access publications by the number of publications, we can see here that Belgium is actually close to the top with 123,000 peer-reviewed open access publications. Of course, by itself, this doesn't mean much. So when we click on the percentage, we can see the share of open access compared to the share of non-open access. So sorting here, we see that actually Belgium is further down the rest of Europe with 79.75%. Again, as always, this depends on the definitions and the constructions, which you can see in the methodology. We also allow here the user to look at affiliated publications and other research products, including non-peer-reviewed publications. And also instead of affiliated, deposited in the country's repositories, including non-peer-reviewed. Okay. Just to clarify that the besides publications, which I briefly skimmed over it, the Open Research Graph has three other types of research outcomes, data sets, software, and other. So we make sure to portray all of them. After some insights and ideas are taken from this, it's time to go more into depth in Europe. There is two ways to do this, by clicking here, detailed view of open access research outcomes in Europe, or directly at the link at the top. Okay, so in the Europe page, let's see. Okay. So there's some summary statistics to begin with. And then there is different tabs that are collections of indicators. A couple of them are inactive, but we will fill them out. So first of all, there is an overview to give a big picture of what's going on in Europe. Open access publications per time, by type. And later, further down, you have open access publications, data sets, software, and other research projects that can be sorted here by country, but that can be seen across different dimensions. So for example, data source, by data source, for top data sources, by organization, and by funder. Now, we would try to keep this breakdown for all important indicators on the platform, to be able to make comparisons and, you know, find weak spots and strong spots and so on. For each of the graphs, they're exporting capabilities. I can download an image or the CSV, so the data actually behind the visualization and perform analysis. Excuse me to interrupt, but there's someone has their microphone on. Okay, moving along to open science. One graph of interest is this one. Here we present the gold versus green open access publications over time. Again, in the methodology, we have the definitions of gold and green and the current construction. All the series in all the graphs can be selected or deselected. For example, so here we have the yellow one is gold only publications, gold open access, gold and green, green only, and neither. So by deselecting these two, we can see the gold open access publications over time. Or by doing this choice, so gold and green and green, we can see the ones that are green. Similarly, we have this for broken down by country, data set, organization, and fund. For example, one interesting thing someone can say is if you look at the organization, there is this interesting case of the Autonoma in Barcelona, where it ranks high, number 4, in the number of gold peer-reviewed publications. However, there are no deposited. None of them are also green, so nothing is deposited. So this says something about the infrastructure, the policy. I don't know the details, of course, but something to look into more detail once you get the insight from this visualization. Okay, and then we created some other indicators, whether there's an abstract, license, PID. I'm going to go into this in a bit more detail in the country page. And there's this more details tab that we keep throughout, where you can see all the indicators together per country with the usual dropdown, so affiliated, including peer-reviewed, deposited, and in deposited, including non-peer-reviewed. And again, you can see it as numbers or as a percentage with sorting capabilities and so on. So it's most clear to have the, it's clear in this table. It's possible to download it and get an aggregate performance across all these indicators, depending on the stakeholders' criteria. Now, we have similar tabs for data sets, and then software and other research products. Again, with the more details in all of them. We have started working on the collaboration metrics, where we're expecting more to come. And again, there is different kinds of indicators. So here we have co-funded. So not too many co-funded publications, but also co-authored. And then per country, the number of collaborations can be seen from these indicators as well. And again, this can also be seen for data sets. Here we have the co-funded ones, software and other research products. Okay. Now, if, for example, a data series doesn't have too many, you know, it's very little, so here it cannot be seen very clearly, although you can always download the data, you can always deselect the other one. And then the axis changes the scale so that the picture is more clear. Okay, let's go now to a country page, which is with the same logic. There's several ways to do that. You can either go from, here's Spain, from the search at the top, or you can go from one of the tables in the more details or in the homepage, or you can activate the map in the Euro page, and then click more details and head over there. I have some idea now of the relative ranking of Spain in terms of some things. For example, one thing of interest is that it has one of the highest productions of data sets. So immediately I want to understand what this is about and get some more insights. So I can go to Open Science, select data sets, and see, for example, a few things. First of all, let me backtrack. I will go to overview first. And then I see that actually the majority of open access data sets happens in 1 year. So it doesn't necessarily say much about making data sets open access and depositing them and so on. But let's look, still there's a large number of data sets. So I go to Open Science to see the metadata quality and so on. So what we see here is open access data sets with a license. And here with a CC license, which is actually more permissive. In most cases, if there's a license that's not CC, the non-CC license is less permissive in most cases. So here I see, first of all, these are very similar, which means most licenses that accompany datasets are CC licenses. And then I see that there are still a few that come without a license. Going into this by organization, I can see, for example, that most of the datasets are coming from this organization. And then another interesting thing is that we have here the University of Alicante that is producing a lot of datasets, but we were not able to fetch them with a license. This kind of, to give you an idea, kind of thinking that you can do. Okay. Similarly, we can look at, as we are in Spain now, we can look at publications and go to licensing there. Now here we can see that there is actually more of a difference between license and CC license, which means that these publications are associated with other licenses, also other licenses rather than CC. And similarly, we can rank the organizations in terms of the license performance, and perhaps we want to see at the weak spots. So to have a better image, we deactivate the no license, the licensing, and we examine how they vary in terms of not providing a license. Similarly by data source and so on. So this was meant to give you an overview of the capabilities of the Open Science Observatory. In terms of the roadmap ahead, so one of the big things that we will have coming up is being able to unfold the story not only by country, but also per scientific field. So the same way that now we're able to select the countries, one would be able to select the scientific field and identify science fields that are moving, have moved further ahead in terms of open science, or ones that are lagging behind. One thing that we're also considering is opening up to the entire global open science landscape, as opposed to just Europe. Again, for all of this, we're not talking only about publications, but different types of research outcomes. As you saw here, the quality of the data, besides the deduplication and cleaning and enriching that has gone through OpenAIR, also depends a lot on the quality of the organization attached, the data attached to the research outcome. So if we don't have properly an organization and the country of that organization, the data quality would be poor or the coverage would be lower. So we're constantly trying to improve on this. And now there is a newly developed tool in OpenAIR called OpenOrgs, where it's specifically about removing ambiguity from the organization database. So a lot of effort is going, as always, on the OpenAIR research graph. The next indicators that we will put online are concerned more fair aspects, so more in detail. Publications cost for open access publications and collaboration networks. And lastly, we're also working on the SDG classification of research outcomes that can be used also throughout the indicators. And I think this is a good time to stop talking and see if there are any questions.
There are. So thanks, Ioana, for the presentation. I think it was very insightful. So there was a question about OpenOrgs, but you mentioned that already, and that was also answered in the chat. The next question. I'm reading that, but you can go in the chat to read them as well in case my my reading is not clear enough. So the Open Science Observatory page in the program description does not appear. A rotating circle is displayed. I'm accessing from Tokyo. Is there any reason you've grasped already? Because the same phenomenon happened about a week ago. So there might be, I don't know, limitations or...
The Open Science Observatory in the program description. Oh, no, it should be fine. I mean, we will have, someone is gonna check on that. And, but there's, we're not trying to exclude anyone. So I'm gonna make a comment about this to remember to take a look at it. Thank
you. Okay.
I'm sorry, we cannot see.
So yeah, so the suggestion will be to check in a few days and see if that's been fixed. Okay, the next question in the row is, how do you define the nationality of repositories, as many are open to deposits globally? I'm thinking about Zenodo, for example.
But it's not about, it's about where the repository is based on. It's not about who is allowed to deposit there.
Okay. So for example, for Zenodo.
And I think we have, Adonis can also reply here, the countries of the data sources, the construction here. He's their data guru.
Yes, hello. As I wrote in the chat, we don't have a country for a data source. We have a country for the managing organization.
Okay, so just to clarify.
For example, Zenodo is from Switzerland.
Yeah, perfect. Perfect example. Many thanks.
For example, the data we show for publications are for institutional repositories. So these are definitely based, these are more country specific. But it's a good idea, I think, to distinguish between the type of repository. So we will make a note for that.
Thanks. The next question is about data updating. So how often are they updated?
Well, the OpenN research graph updates on a biweekly to monthly basis. And the data is automatically updated afterwards. So every time, so first of all, you can see the data, the last updated. So now it's September 14th. And then when the new graph is in production, this will be the queries. There's always a query on the graph, basically.
Thanks. There's another question. Is it possible to see for various variables, what is the share of publications or data sets or other research products for which certain data are missing?
Well, let's see. Let's do share here. Okay, so for example, if you go here where we are in Spain, open access publications with license. Here we have open access publications without license. Okay, and so one can download and calculate the share. Okay, it's not ideal, I know. Or another thing we can do is go to open access in Europe, open science, more details. Here you have the share of publications that have an abstract, a license, a CC license, and so on. So 100 minus this is the share that does. So we're actually in the process now of thinking of examining which visualizations to have this relative measure, so it's easier to see. But you can download the data until we improve on this.
Can I? Sorry to interrupt. It was my question. I'm Jeroen Bosman.
Yeah, please go ahead. Hi.
Yeah, hi. Sorry. Thank you for that answer. But I think there's still a difference between, for instance, having no license and having no information on whether there is a license. So otherwise, you would suggest that for all the publications and data sets, you have all the data available.
Well, given that we merged the right. So we cannot separately identify these two. So that's a very good point. However, the only thing we can do and try to improve on is the coverage of the OpenAI research graph. So for all the content providers that we have, which you can find in graph.openair.edu, that cover, as far as I can tell, the major sources, we merge all the records so that to the best of our ability, there's some academic papers on that if you are interested in the details. And then we keep all the instances. So when we have a publication, for example, we have together all the, in the entire merge record, all possible licenses. Sometimes they come with more than one license or there's incomplete information or whatever. So we try to portray what is actually, is a proxy to what is actually available. Now, if there is a license, for example, attached, but it doesn't exist in any of the metadata records, does it even exist in principle? So, I mean, of course, it all depends on the quality of the graph, and that's why we keep working on that. But we cannot identify separately the two, right?
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So there's one last question, but I believe the answer is simple. If some of the repositories are not listed, I presume for a country specifically, who's the person in charge to be contacted?
So actually this helps me with something I forgot to show.
Perfect.
So thanks for the question. Very good. So if you go to the country page to view the details, here you can see the country page in OpenAI. Which doesn't want to behave, but it's my internet, that's the problem. Here you find information on the notes, and these people can be contacted. Am I saying the right thing?
Yes, right? Yes.
Okay, yes. Good. For including repositories or other organizations in the content providers.
So the workflow is that all data need to be in the OpenAI research graph before being displayed in the observatory. Mm-hmm. And the NOADs, so the contact people from OpenAI at the national level, can help out contacting, reaching out to the repository managers and informing them that their repository is missing from there. Right? Okay. Okay.
So the not there is a question that okay, if the nodes have problem with this, then they can contact here, Antonis Lebesis. Certainly not me, right? I'm kidding. I'm gonna put my email here. If there's any issues that we didn't answer, please contact me directly and we'll find the right person to answer you.
Good, thank you.
Okay, good.
Thanks a lot, Ioana, and to all of you for asking questions. If there's nothing more to ask, you can think about that, and you can ask Ioana because she kindly put her email there. And yeah, I think it's time to close. Thanks a lot, everybody, for being here. And let's see you in 1 hour time for the next plenary. Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.